It's been hip to hate Phil Collins for almost 3 decades. Or maybe you don't hate Phil Collins, but even worse, you ironically like him. Which is hilarious because you're mocking somebody who has literally achieved more in their lifetime than most people ever will. Phil Collins is one of the rare few who has sold 100 million albums both as a solo artist and with his band, Genesis. Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney are the only two other people who can say that in the entire world. Tonight, I would like to take a look at just exactly when did the world turn on Phil Collins. This is the Overstimulation Station. Phil Collins started off in the prog rock band Genesis and in 1981 released his first solo album titled Face Value. This album is a timeless work that features many songs that are still heard on the radio today, namely the atmospheric juggernaut known as In the Air Tonight. Need I say more? Collins went on to record many other successful solo albums throughout the 1980s and also recorded many killer Genesis records as well. But there was something about Phil Collins that was special. Something more entertaining about him than just his singing and drumming abilities. The public wanted more, apparently. And soon Phil Collins was everywhere. He was on late night talk shows, in movies, and making cameo appearances all over the place. Phil Collins became ubiquitous with the 1980s, and like most things involving human nature, we love to send things up just to tear them back down. Maybe it was his perceived arrogance as he kept churning out sappy love song after sappy love song, just raking in the money. Maybe it was his no-frills demeanor of a balding, chubby Londoner who dressed like he was a college professor or golf instructor. Or maybe it was just the oversaturation of his music on FM radio that began to turn public opinion against Phil Collins in a big way. I would say that the world began to turn on Phil Collins at the close of the 1980s. First off, we can't ignore the transitioning musical landscape of the 1980s to the 1990s.
It's not a TV studio! Josh, turn these lights out! It's a fucking rock concert! Ready to stand up!
The type of music Phil made, you know, synth-heavy, drum machine-laden, and often using those admittedly god-awful brass sections, was quickly coming out of style. I keep thinking of Nirvana at this point. In one fell swoop, Smells Like Teen Spirit demolished the sound of the 1980s. Gone were the synthesized, overpolished pop songs. Grunge music alone made acts like Phil Collins seem terminally uncool. On top of that, Phil was beginning to catch flack from some of his songs like Another Day in Paradise, which was written after Phil traveled to Washington, D.C. and saw a large number of homeless people and the apparent complacency of all the wealthy and powerful that surrounded them. This song is still controversial to some. How dare a rich man preach to us about the plight of the homeless as he sits in his mansion? The final straw for most people, however, when it came to Phil Collins, was his supposed divorce facts that occurred in 1994. It was alleged that Phil ended his 10-year marriage with his then-wife, Jill Tavelman, via fax machine. According to Phil, it really hurt my career, or my public persona, and it was based on an untruth, end quote. At this point, the various academies turned their backs on Phil Collins as well. Despite Phil's consistent output in the 1990s with albums like Both Sides and Dance Into the Light, Phil wouldn't see another music award until 2000's Tarzan soundtrack for the song You'll Be In My Heart. This is sadly how most of my millennial friends know of Phil Collins.
I was born in 1988. My dad would let me listen to Phil Collins' cassette tapes that he had at the time, along with other legendary bands like Pink Floyd, but that's a different story. Basically, I grew up in a time where Phil Collins didn't reign supreme over pop culture, so I feel like I can look at the man and his music a little bit more objectively. What I can say about Phil Collins' solo career is, yes, he did have some overly polished pop throwaway songs, but he also had some really great deep cuts that are never talked about or given the respect that they deserve. As far as the band that he started in, Genesis, I mean, everything they've done has been a musical masterpiece as far as I'm concerned. But the weird thing is Genesis never gets the hate that Phil Collins' solo career does. You gotta remember, he did lead vocals in Genesis all throughout the 80s as well, but you never hear them talked about in a negative light. Why is that? Well, mainly because of these two guys right here, Tony Banks and Mike Rutherford. They kind of wrangled Phil in, and they were the buffer that kept Genesis from straying too far off into disposable pop territory. Phil Collins is a rare specimen, though. I mean, the man put out albums at a regular frequency for over 10 years as both his solo project and in Genesis. Meanwhile, doing world tours for both bands, shooting music videos for both bands, and doing all the other things you have to do to make a fruitful musical career. But in two bands, and all the other cameos that he did in probably 100 other projects. Haters are gonna hate, but I feel like at his core, Phil Collins is a very simple man who just liked playing drums and writing songs from his heart. Yeah, sure, everything he did wasn't good, but for fuck's sake, not everything you do is good. I hate the bum rep that Phil Collins has gotten over the years. He's one of my favorite artists and musical inspirations, along with Peter Gabriel, but again, that's a different story. If you don't like Phil Collins, chances are you just haven't heard the right songs yet. So to end this video, I'm going to give you the Cliff Note versions of all the Phil Collins / Genesis songs you need to go out and listen to reevaluate your opinion on this musical legend. I'm Josh Cannon. Thank you for watching.